So let's go for this journey. So this work is a joint work with Thomas Roche, my associate at Ninja Lab, Camille Michler, who is our PhD student, and Laurent Imbert, who is a CNRS researcher. So first, some context on preliminaries about our work. How this journey began? It was in Netherlands, now 3 years ago, at the chess conference. And we had a keynote from Eli Bernstein, who is a Google anti-abuse research team leader. He gave a talk about deep learning and side channel attacks. And at the end of his talk, he made some promotion about the new flagship Google security product and the Google Titan security key. And he even offered some samples to the attendees. So we managed to get one with the idea to check how secure Google will do some hardware stuff. And it was promoted as a trusted hardware. So some words about the product. It's a hardware FIDO U2F token. So the idea is to use this token as a second two-factor authentication. So for instance, to secure your Google account or any other web service supporting FIDO U2F protocol, like your Facebook account, Dropbox, GitHub, and so on and so on. So you have several versions, which are mainly different about the communication interface. But inside, that's the same hardware. So some words about the FIDO U2F protocol. So it's an open standard for two-factor authentication. And now we have the FIDO Alliance managing this standard. But historically, it was developed by Google, Yubico, and NXP. And the idea is like, for instance, with your Google account, basically, you have a login and a password. But it's not really secure because a phishing attack, for instance, can steal your password. So the idea is like every time you connect to your Google account, the FIDO U2F protocol enforces you to present your token with your login and password. So if you don't have your token, you can't connect to your Google account. So from a cryptographic perspective, it's based on public key cryptography, and it uses ECDS signature with the elliptic curve NIST P256, which is quite classical in public key cryptography. And the protocol is really simple. You have two steps. So when you set up your token to be used with your account, there is a registration phase where the token creates an ECDS key pair. So the public key goes to the server and the private key stays inside the hardware token. And every time you authenticate, the server sends a random challenge to the token. The token signs with the private key the challenge and answers to the server the signature. And if the signature is correct, then you can connect to your account. So from this words about the protocol, we can imagine a side channel attack scenario. So the idea is the following. You have the legitimate user, and for instance, during a conference, the evening he goes to a nice dinner, and he go back, he goes to, I don't know, some nightclub after the dinner. So you can steal the token during some hours. You make some measurements, some side channel measurements, by sending some commands to the token. You give back the token to the user, and then you have a lot of side channel measurements, and now you have to extract the secret key to perhaps be able to clone the token. So the first step was to perform a small teardown of the product. So the first surprise we got was that the hardware manufacturer of the product is actually Phaethon. And on the other side of the PCB, you can check that you have a general purpose microcontroller for managing the different communication means, NFC antenna, and a secure element, the NXP 7005. And what is quite interesting is like you have other FIDO U2F products based on this same chip, the really old Yubico YubiKey and some Phytium products. So when we discovered that, we saw that Google subcontracted the hardware development of the product to Phytium. So let's see following. So there is a problem for side channel attackers because in the FIDO U2F protocol you have no way to extract the ECDSL private key. For instance, it's impossible to transfer the user credentials from one FIDO U2F token to another one. And in sidechain attacks, it's really hard to perform a black box sidechain attacks without knowing the key. We often like to have a special version of a product where we can load the secret key, make some studies, and then if we find some vulnerability, to apply it on a real product where we don't know the secret key. So we began to look for samples similar to the NXP R700X, but with a non-key setup. And so we took the NXP R700X datasheet, and we found some interesting characteristics. The operating system is a Java card, the GCOP, which is a NXP Java card operating system. The technological node was not so recent. The CPU is a Secure MX51. You have some crypto coprocessors and so on. So we checked on the web for other NXP products, and we found that several NXP Java card smart cards are old ones based on the NXP P5X chips. Have really close characteristics. So the NXP P5X, or the commercial name is the Smart MX, is the first generation of NXP secure elements. So for people working in smart cards, it's a well-known product. And most of these secure microcontrollers are common criteria and EMV co-certified. And it's actually quite useful because in common criteria certificates, the public version of common criteria certificates of all products, you have interesting information about the product. So it helped us to match between the NXP R700X and these smart cards, that they were really close. And another interesting thing is like we can buy some NXP Java card smart cards on the web, because in the smart card industry it's not so easy to buy secure products. So we choose the NXP G3D 081 because it had the closest characteristics to the secure element of the Titan key, and we called it Rhea in reference to the second largest moon of Saturn after Titan. That's an idea of my buddy Thomas. And we developed a custom Java card applet allowing us to load an ECDSL private key, to perform ECDSL signatures, and to perform ECDSL signature verifications. So we add our training device at this point. So we love electromagnetic measurements at NinjaLab. So we spend some time to open the packages of the devices in order to expose the dies of the chips and to be able to put electromagnetic antennas as close as possible to the dies. So for the Titan's secure element, we used some aluminium tape, and thanks to Olivier for this trick that you gave me some years ago to protect the PCB, and some hot fuming nitric acid to grind inside the epoxy package. And for the smart card, it's easier. You just need a scalpel and some acetone to expose the die. And of course, both devices were still alive after the package opening. Okay. I had to perform several times, especially for the Titan. I lost some samples. So now some words about the side channel acquisition setup. So the electromagnetic sensor, which is here, is a Langer probe. Langer is a really famous German company making electromagnetic sensors. We used a micromanipulator because the sensor is has a coil of 500 micrometers. So you want to be able to position your sensor really precisely on top of the chip. And we used an a picoscope oscilloscope, the high one, but the whole platform cost about 10 kilo euros. So it's not so expensive for hardware attack. And here you can see the EM sensor on top of the die of the Titan. So now we are able to perform our side channel measurements. And when we observe the ECSS signature on Titan and on RIA, we can see that the EM activities are really similar. So it smells good. Now we decided to look for a side channel vulnerability because as it's a secure hardware, it was not clear that we could find anything. And as we are in black box, first we had to reverse engineer the ECDSR signature algorithm. So some words about the ECDSR signature scheme. So you have your elliptic curve, you have the base point G of the elliptic curve, and the order of the elliptic curve. That's the public data about the elliptic curve. So the inputs are the long-term secret key D, and the input message that you want to sign. So the first step, you randomly generate a nonce K, which is a ephemeral secret. You compute the scalar multiplication between the nonce and the base points, which is like the longest operation in the scheme. You keep the first coordinate of this result, and you compute this equation when you mix the previous result with the long-term secret key, and you get your signature. So basically, the two secrets are the long-term secret key, D, of course, and the nonce. So if you can retrieve either the full long-term secret key or the full nonce, you break ECDSA. If you can get parts of one of them, you can still do some stuff. So let's see. So yeah, just a precision. Usually in practice, in secure implementations, you add this step, which allows to randomly project the base point on some, let's say a multiple of the base points to randomize the computation. So now let's go back to the electromagnetic trace of the CDSS signature. So first you have an init phase, probably generation of random data. Then you have the encoding of the base point. Then the scalar multiplication, which is the longest operation in the ECDSR signature scheme. And the final operations where you mix the long-term secret key. So this is a course reverse engineering of the operation. And now if we look inside the scalar multiplication in a range, if we look carefully, we can divide the scalar multiplication, the trace, in several iterations. So it's a regular implementation. That's something typical for secure scalar multiplication implementations. We call it in the crypto world double and add always. And we counted exactly 128 iterations. And remember, we are on the elliptic curve P 256. So we can deduce that each iteration processes 2 bits of the nonce at a time. So if we look closely to one scalar multiplication iteration, we can even divide them in two parts, the double part and the add part. So what we got until now, the scalar multiplication is a constant type algorithm. We have 128 iterations for 256 bit nonce. So it's 2 bits by of the nonce used by iteration, and the point is randomized. So now we took a look on the signature verification command, because the signature verification only process public data. You have no secret involved. So often developers, they don't add security to the signature verification. So you have the init, the precomputation, and two scalar multiplications. I don't spend some time to explain deeper the mathematics behind, but when looking for one of the two scalar multiplications in the verification command, we could check that the algorithm is no more regular. You have like double, add, double, double, add. It's no more double and add always. So it was a really good help for us, because we could match the value of the scalar to the different iterations. And thanks to that, we were able to reverse engineer the scalar multiplication algorithm. Basically, my buddy Thomas took all the literature about implementing elliptic curve scalar multiplications and all the techniques, all the non-techniques, and he tried like a brute force to match what we were observing to the known techniques. And we found that the technique that NXP use is a left to right method of RISC-2. So how does it work? You have your scalar K, okay? So you write it in binary form, and you took the upper half and the lower half, and then you take one bit of each. And so that's how you process 2 bits by 2 bits the scalar. And 2 bits allows us to have like 4 precomputed points, P0, P1, P2, P3. And depending on the value 0, 1, 2, or 3 of the 2 bits of scalars, you add one of the points. There is also a trick with P0, which is a dummy value, but I don't go deeper here. So now we can associate a nonce bit pair to an electromagnetic subtrace, the subtrace of one iteration, which corresponds to the scalar multiplication. So now to exhibit a sensitive side channel leakage linked to the nonce bit pairs, what we have to do? So we take n ECDSA signatures. So we have n EM traces, each one of 128 iterations. So we split each EM trace in subtraces corresponding to the different iterations. So we get 128 by n subtraces, and we can match the bit pairs of the scalars to each subtrace. And then we have this 128 by Hain subtraces and the corresponding bit pairs. And we can now compute a statistical, side channel statistical test, typically a SNR or a t-test, between the nonce bit pairs and the EM subtraces. And if significant peaks appear in the resulting statistical trace, then it means that we found a correlation between the nonce bit pairs and the electromagnetic subtraces. And then we have a way to guess the nonce bit pairs from the electromagnetic measurements. So that's what we did. So let's go back to the one iteration. Huh? Actually, it will be here that we will find some leakage dependency. So here you have like on the top several electromagnetic subtraces superposed, and below you have the SNR trace. So you can see that we have big peaks at several instances. So it means that we found some side channel leakage. We also computed the t-test over the most significant bit and the least significant bit of K of the nonce. And we found also that each bit individually is strongly correlated to the electromagnetic measurements. Some illustration, like here you have a lot of superposed part of traces. In red, it's traces where the most significant bit of the nonce bit pair is equal to zero. And in blue, it's when it's equal to one. And you can see that there is kind of a separation. When it's a zero, the curve is a bit higher than when it's equal to one. So that's a way to show the statistical dependence, the side channel dependence between the EM traces and the processed bits. So now that we have exhibited a side channel leakage linked to the nonce bit pairs, we are quite happy. But to extract this side channel dependency, we need thousands of subtraces. And in ECDSA signature, remember, the nonce is randomly picked up for every new signature. So actually, what we need to transform this vulnerability into an exploit, we need to design a side channel process allowing us to matching with a very, very high probability a single electromagnetic subtrace to a nonce bit pair value. So for that, in the side channel literature, we have several tools. If we use supervised tools, you have template attacks and deep learning tools. And if you want to do something unsupervised, you can use clustering or deep learning in a non-supervised setup. So we began by using clustering because it's kind of the most simple technique. And what we did for each subtrace, we first perform a pre-processing with some signal processing tricks. And then we designed a clustering algorithm based on expectation maximization, allowing us to match that this subtrace corresponds to a bit pair or something like that. And actually, it was easier. We had the best match by just trying to match each electromagnetic subtrace to the most significant bit. We had like a success rate of 99%. That's really high. So remember that here we studied the side channel dependency of each bit of the bit pair, and the most significant bit, you can see it has three high peaks and the least one only one. So it could explain why we had the best matching with just trying to match on the most significant bit of each bit pair. So now, for each ECDSA signature that we process, we can identify the MSB equal to zero. And so here, you have a representation of different nonces used during different signatures. And you can see that for some indices, we were able to match with a really high probability that it's a zero which is processed. In average, we have a bit more than 27 bits at zero by nonce. So it's cool, but how do we transform that to find the full long-term secret? So, you have a lot of literature about this kind of problems in the cryptographic world. And it's even as a name, it's called the hidden number problem. So the idea is like you have partial knowledge of the nonces used in your ECDSA signatures. And you want to find the long-term secret key. So the idea is like you consider that the you consider these problems as games with an oracle, and the oracle reveals x and a function of x for several random values of x, and the goal is to find the value alpha which is mixed with x, and alpha is a long-term secret key, of course. So HNP, it's when you only know some most significant bits of your scalar, and the extended number problem. Hidden number problem, sorry, it's when you know some bits scattered over the all over the nonce. And we are in this case. because as you can see here, we have some knowledge of zeros all over the nonces, but it's not the all together. So we ran some simulations before trying to exploit our results, and we could check that with 80 signatures, with at least five consecutive nonce bits, we were able to retrieve the full long-term secret key. So what we did, we observed 4,000 ECDSA signatures from the smart card. We extracted the subtraces. We used our clustering algorithm to match and to find the zeros. We knew that with 99%, we still had some errors. So first, we had to perform a pruning phase to only keep the nonces where we had at least a minimum of five consecutive known bits. So from 4,000, we got 180 only nonces. And then, as we knew that we still had some errors in this 180 nonces, and also we knew that with 80 signatures from simulation, it's enough to retrieve the full secret key, we randomly selected 80 signatures among the 180 available to perform kind of a brute force attack on random subsets. So the final attack, the numbers are the acquisition of 4,000 traces, it's about 4 hours. The trace processing, it's about 4 hours. And the brute force attack, it's about 20 minutes. So at that time, we were able to extract the long-term ECDSA secret key from the smart card RIA. But we were still in a known key setup. It was kind of easy because we were loading the long-term secret key, perform the attack, and check that at the end, okay, we find back the correct key. So now we had to apply this attack process to the Titan key because that was the main goal. So we use the exact parameters from RIA for the point of interaction, point of interest extraction. Sorry, it was not so easy because the two chips are really similar, but they were running at slightly different frequencies. And so yeah, we said okay, let's use the same parameter from RIA, and we took a little bit more traces, 6,000 signatures. And we applied the same process with the brute force trick, and finally it took roughly the same time to perform the full attack. So some conclusion. So the proposed attack allows to physically extract the ECDSA private key linked to an application account secured by FIDO U2F. But the attack requirements are quite high, because first the adversary has to have already stolen the victim's account login and password, for instance with a phishing attack. Then the adversary needs physical access to the Titan key during like 10 hours, it's a long night. And the adversary have to have access to a chemical lab or a mean to seen IC package to put the EM sensor as close as possible to the die. Kind of expensive sidechain attack setup and custom softwares. So the attack is not so easy to perform, and clearly it's still safer to use your Titan key rather than nothing, or even rather than a software FIDO U2F app. You know that you have software applications that you can install, for instance, on your smartphone, which performs the same kind of process than the hardware tokens, but clearly hardware tokens are more secure. So we also checked how attack impact different products. So about FIDO U2F tokens, so the Titan security key is impacted in all versions. The really old YubiKey Neo, but the product now is discontinued like since several years. So if you have a kind of recent YubiKey, no worry. It's based on Infineon secure elements, quite recent Infineon secure elements. And the Phytium FIDO U2F tokens also are based on the NXP secure elements, so they are impacted. And also all the NXP Java card platforms based on the P5X chips, so the old ones, are impacted. So you have like all these products. And finally, with our exchanges with NXP, they confirmed us that all the NXP P5X and A7X products using the crypto lib for elliptic curve up to version 2.9 are vulnerable. But another point also about NXP secure elements. The P5X or SmartMX family is a really old one. And since you have two new families, SmartMX2, SmartMX3. So if you have products or if you use products with recent NXP secure elements, you are safe against this attack. So some words of about mitigating the attack. A first way would be to hardening the NXP crypto library, either by blinding, randomizing the Scala, or you could also re-randomizing the table lookup of pre-computed points at each new access. But it would imply to modify the crypto library on secure elements that could be that cannot be updated over the air. So that's often a problem in the smart card industry. It's like your banking card cannot be updated when you take some money at an ATM. Sadly. And there is another way in the FIDO U2F protocol. You have a notion of counter, which allows to detect clones. And so if on the server side, the implementation of the FIDO protocol uses this counter trick. It can detect cloned devices, but it only limits the validity of the attack. It means that if you create a clone of a U2F token, you and the service use the counter trick. You, as an adversary, you will still be able to connect one time to the account that you hacked before that the counter detects the clone. Finally, some words about the project's timeline. So we got the first samples of the Titan key in 2018. A lot of time before we really dig inside the attack. Actually, it was thanks to the first COVID pandemic lockdown that we found the time to work on this project, and that's why that we fully validated the attack on Rhea as a kind of end of the lockdown, and as you can see, a few days later, once we validated the attack on Rhea, we are able to reapply it on Titan. And in October, we contacted Google, Phytium, NXP, and also ANSI and BSI, which are the French and German cybersecurity agencies, for sharing a technical description of our work and a summary of our coordinated responsible disclosure plan. And beginning of this year, we published our work and we assigned a CVE. If you want more details, because it's a kind of a huge work, especially my associate Thomas made a crazy work about black box reverse side channel reverse engineering of secure crypto implementation. We wrote a really long technical report, which is available on internet. And for people who are like really interested by this subject, I encourage you to look at the report. We spent so many time to write it. So yeah. And that's all for me. Thank you for your attention. And if you have any question.
Do we have any questions?
Thank you very much for this presentation. It's very nice work and really involved. My question is, you presented a side channel attack. Have you thought about fault attacks? Because if I understand well, it should be possible to extract the key with faults. So why are you choosing side channel instead of faults?
Because at Ninja Lab, we are skilled in side channel attacks and not so skilled in fault attacks. So yeah, we had to make a choice. Clearly, with Thomas, we are like side channel guys. And, but yeah, yeah, it's probably, yeah. And also, on this kind of cryptographic, operations, to my point of view, it's easier to protect this kind of implementation against fault, or at least cheaper from a computational time perspective than protecting sidechain attacks. But I know that you know that well, perhaps better than me. So, yeah.
Thank you very much for the talk. During the presentation, you mentioned about using clustering techniques, among others. So I would like to know, so first of all, which algorithm did you use, and have you also spent the time to explore some other, for instance, supervised approach?
So we hesitated to use supervised approaches, but as the idea was to find an attack on Rhea in a known key setup and then being able to apply it on the Titan key in an unknown key setup, we took that making measurements to create like templates or applying neural networks on Rhea and trying to apply it on Titan could be not so easy because the spatial position of the electromagnetic sensor would not be exactly the same. Both chips were not running exactly at the same frequency. So and also unsupervised attacks, to my point of view, are like more powerful than supervised ones. So we tried clustering, and also it's easier to implement. You have really nice Python libraries to do that, and really kind of simple. And so we tried the both classical techniques of clustering, which is K-means and EM, expectation maximization. It's EM which works the best. So that's what we used here.
Thank you for your presentation, and I just have a question regarding, did you try to monitor the traces without decapping the chip?
Not really. We got several times these questions. That's interesting, especially since now we found a vulnerability and we know where to put spatially the sensor. We didn't do that, but this family of secure elements is kind of known to be kind of noisy from a side channel measurement perspective, and so I think that it probably wouldn't work, but you never know. In this kind of hardware stuff, you never know until you try. So yeah. That's a good question. But for instance, if we were like moving just a bit the EM sensor on the decapped chip, the signal was totally different. So even with an open chip, the spatial position of the sensor was really important to have the EM signal corresponding to the crypto activity. So I guess that with the package, the signal would be not so wouldn't bear in-house side channel information.
I have another question regarding the fault attack countermeasures in the chip itself.
Sorry?
The fault attack countermeasures on the chip itself, did you see any sensors?
We didn't try any glitch, any lazy injection or so on. So we were just like listening to the chip. And so the chip was not aware we were trying to harm it. So, and in the reverse engineering of the command, we didn't see something which would show a fault countermeasure, even if I'm quite sure that this implementation has fault countermeasures, of course.
I have one more question as well. So what was their response when you reported the problems? I mean, what are they going to do?
We had good... The responsible disclosure was quite good. Google and NXP mainly were nice with us. Google said that it's a complicated attack, so they will continue to use, the Googler will continue to use the Titan key, and they will continue to sell it. And it's normal to my point of view. And NXP was kind of aware of this potential vulnerability. And as they have seen several years, new families of secure elements, it was not so bad for them. The main problem, I guess, is like, they still have all products on the field using this generation of secure elements. So they had to manage some stuff with customers, but NXP is a big company. They have a dedicated response team, so I guess they are used to it.
Yeah, I mean, that's always the problem with hardware. You will have a huge amount of legacy devices already deployed. So, one more question here.
About the 6 hours, did you have like good success with the one chip with 4 hours and just increased it because the other chip was less known? Or did the 6 hours was like a minimum time to get good results? Or could we get the time more down? Like with less traces, maybe success probability would be still acceptable?
I think, if I remember well, the 6 hours is like we evaluated like one big hour to open the case of the Titan key and to see in the IC package, and then some hours of measurements, but yeah. I guess it could be improved. For instance, the oscilloscope we used, there is some special modes to increase the measurement time. So if I would be an intelligence agency and I would have to apply this attack, probably I will work to reduce some part of the process. So probably you can perhaps divide in two the required time
Okay, so you didn't analyze how many traces are needed for example 90% success probability or 95 or something like that.
We did that, but you have the side channel process, and then you have the lattice attack about the hidden number problem. And the lattice attack, the mathematical attack at the end, you have to know exactly the known bits you feed inside the lattice attack. The algorithm cannot accept errors. It's non-error tolerant. Okay. So. Yeah. If we decrease the percentage of the side channel matching process, then we will have trouble applying the lattice attack. Okay. So it was a kind of That's why we chose, and that was a trick of Thomas to only try to guess the most significant bits of the non-bit pairs because we had a really good match on them. And okay. But probably that with more time and more effort, you could improve the whole process. At the end, it's only a question of time. Huh?
Thank you very much.
Security.
Okay, no more questions. That was a great talk, really interesting stuff. Thank you.